ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय. So in our last class, we have already had two classes. The first class was an introduction class on how we got the Brahma Samhita and what is the contents of the Brahma Samhita, how the Brahma Samhita is organized, how many verses are there, and how it is classified. Then in the second class, we saw about the supreme position of Krishna, the first verse of the Brahma Samhita, where it talks about saying that Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead, and how we compared it to the Krishna to Bhagavan Swayam. Then we discussed about how it is the Paribhasha Sutra of the Brahma Samhita. Then we also saw how in Krishna's abode is. That is, Krishna's abode. In Krishna's abode, both Gokul and Goloka are the same. That is, the material realm Gokul as well as the spiritual world Goloka, they are actually facsimiles, or they are very similar to each other. And it is this this Vrindavan, or the material Vrindavan on the material world, is only an extension of the spiritual world. And then we also saw some examples from different scriptures proving that point. And we also saw examples from different scriptures proving that Goloka Vrindavan is indeed the supremest spiritual abode. Topmost Vaikuntha is Goloka Vrindavan, where Krishna holds the cows. So we have seen sufficient proof in these two verses, verse 1 and verse 2, for all these points. Now we'll be continuing with verse 3 and verse 4, and we will get more details about the abode of Krishna, which is Goloka Vrindavan. Now, these two verses, that is verse 3 and verse 4 of the Brahma Samhita, are very, very technical. Technical in the sense you don't need much intelligence to understand it, but it's very esoteric, you know. It is very difficult for us to have the realized knowledge of what we are talking today. So it requires a lot of attention. So please try to hear attentively, because even if you miss anything little bit, you'll be totally lost. So if you can, please try to hear attentively. And you might have to refer the three pictures that is I have sent to your, as a message to all of you. Three pictures, that is, one is a yantra, a picture of a yantra, which is called as the Goloka Yantra. Then one is a close-up picture of Goloka Vrindavan. And the other one is a far-off picture of Goloka Vrindavan. That is a pink lotus. One is focusing the center point. The other one is focusing the petal. So two pictures like that in pink, and one yantra picture. It is a yantra format. It looks like a yantra. So that is a Goloka yantra. So you will be concentrating on these three pictures while I'm talking. So unless you look at these pictures and follow what I'm saying, it's very difficult to understand. And I also had this problem, like when I was trying to listen to the seminars, it was very difficult. But if we give a little attention, it's not so bad. So in fact, Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj as well as Rampad Maharaj, I was listening to their seminars, and both of them said the same thing. In fact, their comment was the same. Both of them said the same thing. They said, if you understand these two verses, that is verses 3 and 4 of Brahma Samhita, you can understand any topic in Krishna consciousness. You can just simply understand anything in Krishna consciousness. You can understand all the BBT publications that have been done so far. That is what they said. I won't say any topic in Krishna consciousness, because there are many advanced topics. But what they are saying is you can understand anything that has been published by BBT so far, if you understand these two. Understanding, of course, doesn't need intelligence, but it just requires some attention, and we can surely understand it. But we may not be able to understand it and get realized knowledge that will take practice. But just we will get the knowledge in a simple level. Like we can just understand, this is the knowledge, that's all. To have the realization, maybe it's very esoteric, so we will understand, get realized knowledge much later as we advance in Krishna consciousness. But just to know what is what is enough for the time being. Okay, so please pay attention and follow the pictures when I start talking. And when I'll tell specifically which picture to refer, how to refer the picture, all that. Okay, so we'll start off with the prayers. Om Ajnana Tinirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Nilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langayati Girim Yat Kripa Tamaiham Vande Shri Gurum Dinatarinam Namaom Vishnapadaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschayate Deshatarine Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadara Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Okay, now I'll read the verse. We'll do word by word translation and then purport. I will not read the purport, but I will be talking from the purport, especially for verse 5.3, because if I read the purport, nobody will understand anything. So I will talk, that is, I will present the purport in my own words as what, or rather in the words of our Maharajas who have given seminars. Okay, verse 5.3. Karnikaram mahatyantram shatkonam vajrakilakam shatanga shatpadi sthanam prakritya purushena cha premananda mahananda rasena avastitanam hiyat Jyotirupena Manuna Kama Bijena Sangatam. Word for word translation. Karnikaram, the world. Mahat, great. Yantram, figure. Shatkonam, a hexagon. Vajra, like a diamond. Kilanam, the central support. Shad Anga Shatpadi, the 18 syllable mantra with 6 fold divisions. Sthanam, the place of manifestation. Takar, Prakritya, along with the predominated aspect of the absolute truth. Purushena, along with the predominating aspect of the absolute. Cha, also. Prema Ananda, the bliss of love of God. Maha Ananda, the great transcendental jubilations. Rasena, with the rasa, mellow. Avasthitam, situated. He, certainly, yet, which. Jyoti Rupena, transcendental. Manuna, with the mantra, Kama Bijena, with the Kama Bij clean, Sangatam, joined. Translation, the world of the transcendental lotus is the realm wherein dwells Krishna. It is a hexagonal figure, the abode of the indwelling predominated and predominating aspect of the absolute. Like a diamond, the central supporting figure of self-luminous Krishna stands as the transcendental source of all potencies. The holy name, consisting of 18 transcendental letters, is manifested in a hexagonal figure with 6 fold divisions. Okay? So this is the verse. Now, so actually in this verse, I will just, first we'll see the translation in simple words, what the translation means. So in this verse, we see a description of the center point of Golokadham. So already in the first two verses, we have seen, okay, the supremeost abode is Goloka Vrindavan. And in Goloka Vrindavan, Radha and Krishna reside and Krishna is a cowherd boy. This is what we have seen so far. Now, we are going to focus into that Golokadham. So all of you have the picture of the Golokadham. Otherwise, even if you have the picture of the Goloka chart in your house, you can focus and see the center point of Golokadham. So the center of, you know, the center of the lotus, the pink lotus, you see a world. You know, world is that yellow color that is in the center of the flower. In the center of all the petals, there is a yellow color world that is called as a world. So in the center of the flower and center of all the petals, there is a world, okay? Now this world, it is hexagonal, six-sided world. Actually, it's not a concentric world. Rather, it is hexagonal, six-sided. In fact, if you see that yellow color world, you will see that there is a hexagon drawn there. You know, like two triangles. Like we put all these rangoli in front of our house, right? Like two triangles upside down and one straight. So like that, there is a hexagon that is drawn inside. So this world itself is supposed to be in the form of a hexagon. Okay? And inside this hexagon, there is the predominating and the predominated aspects of the absolute. That means there is Radha and Krishna. The predominating is Radha, is Krishna, and predominated is Radha. One who's predominated is Radha, one who predominates everything, the controller, the one who's the energetic, you know, that is Krishna. So we have the energy and the energetic, or the predominated and the predominator. So Radha and Krishna are centered and they are standing on that world. In the picture you can see Radha and Krishna, you can see the hexagon edges you can see inside that yellow color world. Okay, so here Krishna stands and this area is like a diamond, okay, and it supports everything. Who's supporting everything? Krishna, who's standing there, is supporting the entire dham, situated like a diamond in the center of the world. Okay, so the holy name has a form, okay, we know Hare Krishna Mahamantra is nothing but Krishna. Similarly, there is a holy name. It's not Hare Krishna Mahamantra, but rather it is the Gopala Mantra, okay, that is permeating there. And this holy name has 18 letters, and it is in a hexagonal form. So the translation said that it is an 18-syllable holy name. And that is the Gopala Mantra, and we'll go in detail about the Gopala Mantra. So the Gopala Mantra is actually there. You can see how the Gopala Mantra is situated in a hexagonal form. So in that, that structure, that hexagonal structure, like you see two triangles, one is inverted and one is straight, there you will see the Gopala Mantra written inside. So these hexagonal structure also contains the mantra, which is also hexagonal. Okay, and it has the same form as the whirl of the lotus, and the mantra has words on all its six sides. So this is the translation in my own words, or in simple words, of the of what is being told as translation of this verse. Okay, now talking about the Lord's pastimes. So this is an idea of how the central world of Goloka Vrindavan looks like. We said that it is the central point, and there you have Radha and Krishna, and it is Shatkonam. There's a hexagonal yantra there. You know, you can see a hexagonal yantra, and there is a mantra around that yantra, and that mantra is the Gopala Mantra, which has the Kama Bija clean. Okay. Further details on the Gopala Mantra, we will go. I think all of you know the Gopala Mantra because we've already attended classes in the past about Gopala Mantra. So the mantra starting with clean is situated there. Okay, now talking about the Lord's pastimes. So there are two types of pastimes of the Lord, of Lord Krishna. There are two varieties of pastimes. One is the manifest pastimes and the other one is the unmanifest pastimes. Now what is the difference between the two? What do we mean by manifest and what do we mean by unmanifest? So when Krishna is personally present, okay, when Krishna comes down to earth once in a day of Brahma, he's personally present there and he performs his pastimes. And everyone can see him. Everyone can see his transcendental form. Such pastimes are known as manifest pastimes. So when Krishna came 5,000 years ago, everyone could see him. Kamsa could see him, Venukasura could see him. Everybody could see him. And even Yashoda and Nanda and the Gopas and the Gopis, the queens of Dwaraka, everybody saw him, right? So when he is present there personally for you and he is manifesting his pastimes, then these pastimes are called as manifest pastimes. In Sanskrit, it's called as Prakata Leela. Prakata means to be manifest. So he is manifest there. Now, other than the manifest pastimes, there is also pastimes known as unmanifest pastimes or Aprakata Leela. Now, what is Aprakata Leela? So these pastimes are the pastimes that is going on in Goloka Vrindavan. Now we are on earth, so we cannot see the pastimes that are happening in Goloka Vrindavan. So we don't see it. So for our eyes, it is aprakata. That means we are not able to get a vision of these pastimes. So the pastimes that are happening now in Goloka Vrindavan is aprakata to us. But of course, the people there are able to see it, but we are not able to see it. So in our perspective, the Goloka Vrindavan pastimes are aprakata. Okay. Now there is also one more variety of Aprakata Leela. So what is that? That is interesting. We have all heard, even in the previous class, we were talking about how this Gopakumara was going up and down. He was going to the spiritual world and he was seeing the material world also. And he was saying there is no big difference between the two. I see the same thing here and there. And we were talking about Krishna's pastimes eternally happening in Vrindavan. We always say that, right? Even in our general discussions, we always very coolly we say, oh yeah, Krishna's pastimes are happening every minute in Vrindavan, but we don't have the eyes to see it, right? So what is that? That is also called as aprakata leela. Actually, that is true. Even now, if you go to Vrindavan, of course, we don't see it, but Krishna's pastimes are happening there every minute. Every minute, there's a pastime that is going on. Krishna is performing pastimes there. Even if he is not present in his physical, in the prakata form, or rather in a form in which we perceive him, but still, these pastimes are going on. So such pastimes that are happening on earth in Vrindavan Dham is also called as aprakata leela, which we don't see. And the pastimes that are happening in Goloka Vrindavan are also called as aprakata leela. So there are two varieties of aprakata leela and one variety of prakata leela. So the next prakata leela in this particular universe, in this particular earth, we are going to see is during the next day of Brahma. Till then, we don't have a chance unless we are transported to a different Brahmanda, a different universal like of Brahma. We cannot see the prakata leela. So there is one variety of prakata leela, two varieties of aprakata leela. Two varieties are one which is in Goloka Vrindavan, the other one which is continuously happening even now. But unfortunately, we don't have the spiritual life to see it. Okay? So like that, there are two varieties of aprakata leela. Now, and there are many, like last class I was talking about this Gopa Kumara saying that he was able to see the aprakata leela going on here, and he was saying there's no difference between Goloka Vrindavan and Vrindavan. Similarly, even Prabodhananda Saraswati, who talks about Vrinda, actually he did a work called Vrindavan Mahimamrita. It's a great poetic work. So even in his work, he talks about how everything is just like Goloka Vrindavan inside the Bauma Vrindavan, or the Vrindavan of this world. He's saying how it is so similar. He gives description that he's able to see the leaves as emeralds, and the fruits as rubies, like that. He's seeing Goloka Vrindavan inside the material Vrindavan. So he's able to see the aprakata pastimes of the Lord, just like Gopa Kumara. So there are many testimonies for this happening. Okay. Now, Jiva Goswami explains that there is one major difference in Krishna in his manifest and unmanifest form in the material world Gokul. That is, in the as I said in the previous class itself, we will refer to Bhauma Vrindavan or the earthly Vrindavan as Gokul, and we'll refer to the spiritual world as Goloka. Okay, so when I say Gokul, that means we should immediately remember it is the earth. Okay, the pastimes of Krishna happening in earth. So Jiva Goswami explains that there is one major difference in Krishna in his manifest and unmanifest form in Gokul. Okay, so we are not seeing the unmanifest form yet. We are only 5,000 years ago, if we were born and if we had the mercy, we would have seen the manifest pastimes. So Jiva Goswami is explaining there's a major difference, only one major difference between Krishna and his manifest and unmanifest pastimes in Gokul. Okay, in the non-manifest form on earth, okay, that form of Krishna, that is pure Krishna form. It doesn't include all the other incarnations. This is a famous thing that we read in the Krishna book, that when Krishna manifested himself 5,000 years ago, all the incarnations like Narsingha, Vamana, Varaha, everybody, they entered Krishna. And in fact, when Krishna was killing the demons, actually he was not doing it. Vishnu was doing it through the agency of Krishna. Right? So we read that. That means Krishna, since he is Swayam Bhagavan, all the incarnations are already present inside Krishna when he manifests himself. So when he came 5,000 years ago, Krishna had all the incarnations within him. And all these incarnations were working full-time and Krishna was enjoying. So that is the realization of our acharyas. Now, during the aprakata manifest leela, that is happening every minute in Bhauma Vrindavan or in this earthly Vrindavan, these incarnations are not present inside Krishna and Krishna doesn't kill demons. Okay? There are only beautiful pastimes of Radha Krishna enjoying, gopis enjoying, gopas enjoying. So the aprakata leela doesn't have killing demons. It doesn't have the other incarnations present in the body of Krishna. Okay, that is the only difference. And we should always understand that the earthly Gokul is just an extension of Goloka Vrindavan and they are not different. Just because we don't see it with our eyes, it doesn't mean that these things are not happening. Okay? Now, theoretically I'm saying these are happening, these are happening, these are happening. But if somebody wants to really visualize these pastimes now, okay, they want to see the Aprakata Leela. What is the method? How can they start seeing the Aprakata Leela with their eyes? So that is a question that one might ask. So there are two methods of approaching the non-manifested pastimes. That is, we are just theoretically saying, oh, pastimes are happening every minute. But are we able to see? We are not able to see. But we just can accept our acharyas. So one may ask, I want a method to start seeing these pastimes. So is there a method? Yes, there are two methods. So now we have to get into understanding the process of seeing these non-manifest pastimes of Krishna and Vrindavan. So there are two processes, and these two processes are at two different levels. Okay. So the first process is called as mantra upasana. That means, obviously, we all know the meaning of mantra upasana. That means chanting a mantra. Okay. Worship through channels of mantras. And with practice of chanting that mantra, one can purify himself. Okay, that is the first stage. That is, you are given a mantra and you begin to chant that mantra. Now, at the second stage, is called as swarasaki. Swarasaki. The first stage is called as mantra upasana. Mantra upasana, I'll give you more rules about mantra upasana in a while. But basic first stage is mantra upasana. A guru gives a particular mantra, especially when we get second initiation, we get a lot of Brahminical mantras. Okay. At this stage, we don't get all that. We just get the Maha Mantra, which is the names of the Lord. But during second initiation, you will get Bija mantras. Mantras with Bija, like clean. We just found that word. There is a Bija, there is a clean. So mantras with Bijas will be given during second initiation. So when you start doing mantra upasana like that, for a specific purpose, like for example, some person has a specific rasa that he has with Krishna, he'll be given a specific mantra with a specific bija. Okay, so mantra upasana is the first stage of trying to see the non-manifest pastimes. Now, a person begins with mantra upasana and then he moves on to stage two, which is known as swarasaki. So, swarasaki is nothing but spontaneous love for Krishna. So, this happens at a very perfect level and at a pure level. So they become one with Krishna on a transcendental platform, and they are seeing and speaking with Krishna. That means for them, herding cows, participating in the pastimes of Krishna, everything becomes a reality. That is, they enter into the non-manifested pastimes on earth. So the first stage, they are chanting mantras. In the second stage, they advance so much that they begin to have that spontaneous love where they just enter into the pastimes of Krishna that is happening in a non-manifested form, in the Aprakata Leela that is happening on earth. They start entering these pastimes. And at that time, pure love pours out from their heart and they enter into their relationship with Krishna. Whatever eternal relationship they have with Krishna, for example, if a person has a relationship of being a cowherd boy or a sakha of Krishna, then he will enter into the pastimes of, you know, going with Krishna to the grasslands and taking cows and having fun pastimes with Krishna, playing games with Krishna, he will enter into those pastimes. First, he will chant mantras, then spontaneous devotion will happen and he will enter into that pastime, into the Aprakata, where he's sitting on Bhavana Vrindavan, he enters into these pastimes. Okay, so from mantra upasana, we reach a stage of swarasaki. Okay, swarasaki means in terms of his own rasa. He will enter into the pastimes in terms of his rasa. So, one way just leads to the other. So when, that is the first stage one, mantra upasana should lead to swarasaki. Actually, only in the stage of swarasaki, he sees Krishna. Though it is called as two separate processes, actually one leads to the other. It is actually in total one process, but it has two stages. And hence it's called as two processes. Okay. Now regarding chanting mantras, so we spoke about mantra upasana. So is it just like I go and chant a mantra and I enter into the pastime, I start seeing the non-manifest Vrindavan suddenly in front of my eyes? No, it's not so easy. So regarding chanting mantras, there are many rules. So these are the rules. One must stay in a holy place. Okay. Like for example, let's take Vrindavan. One must stay in Vrindavan. One must meditate on only one pastime. Okay, like for example, I'm just giving a random example. If a person is meditating on the Damodar Leela, he should meditate only on that pastime. He should not be meditating on multiple pastimes. He should not be meditating on Krishna stealing butter and Krishna playing with the gopis or the gopas. He should not meditate like that randomly. He He should be continuously meditating only on one pastime, and he should be only in that place where the pastime happened. So if Krishna was bound to the mortar in a particular place, he should be sitting there in that place, and he should be meditating on that pastime. And this place should be suitable to the pastime that happened, and he should meditate on the mantra, and he must become perfect like that. So this is how the mantra upasana happens. The mantra is given by the guru, okay? And he should meditate on one particular pastime in the place preferably where the pastime happened, and his atmosphere should be suitable for his meditation. So then he's successful in mantra upasana over a period of time. Then once he's successful in mantra upasana, he perfects his chanting, then he enters into the pastime, that particular pastime that he's meditating on. He enters. He's able to see the Aprakata Leela happening in front of his eyes. He's able to see the non-manifested Vrindavan coming live in front of his eyes. Like we say, oh, this Vrindavan we are not able to see because of our material coverings, right? Those material coverings are removed and he's able to see the Aprakata Leela. So once he enters the one pastime in the Aprakata Leela, then he immediately flows from one pastime to the other. So he just needs one entry. Once he enters that particular pastime, for him, it's not like if he has to go to another pastime, he has to sit and meditate again. No. Once he enters that pastime, he simply flows into the rest of the pastimes of Krishna, and he's able to continuously witness everything that is happening in Vrindavan, all the Aprakata Leela that is happening in Vrindavan. So this is the process that is explained in this verse. I mean, explained by Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur in his purport in this verse. Okay? So one enters the pastime in the Swarasati level, then one enters one pastime to the other, and he's swept from one pastime to the other along with Krishna, and he's with Krishna in a transcendental thought form. Okay, now let's look at some examples. This is theory again. We have to see examples of people who experience this. So we know Mother Janava Devi. Janava was the wife of Lord Nityananda, second wife of Lord Nityananda. So Janava Devi was in Radha Kund, and actually interestingly, she was chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Even the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra has that potency. Not only, like I was first talking about mantras with Bija, that is for a particular rasa, actually, you know, to meditate on a particular rasa that you have with the Lord. But anyhow, here we have Janava Devi. She was just meditating on Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, sitting in Radha Kund, and then she saw a bridge going across Radha Kund, and there she saw Radha and Krishna crossing the bridge. So she saw the unmanifest pastimes that are happening in Vrindavan in front of her eyes. And this was recorded in a journal after she came back. Then there is another pastime. This is the famous pastime of Rupa Goswami. So Rupa Goswami once, see these Goswamis, they were able to see the non-manifested Vrindavan very easily, all these Goswamis. And at the time of Goswamis, there were many pure devotees who were able to enter the unmanifested pastimes. So Rupa Goswami, there's a famous story where he was actually seeing the pastimes between Radha and Krishna, and Radha and Krishna were having a very funny conversation. So Radha was saying something really funny, and Krishna was saying back something really funny. So when he was seeing these two, Radha and Krishna, you know, talking like this, Rupa Goswami got so much involved in their pastimes that he started laughing. Okay? So since he was laughing in his since he had entered this unmanifested pastimes, he was sitting there and laughing. His external body was also laughing. He was like really bursting out into laughter. So it so happened that at that time, an old Brahmana who was a little limping, you know, he was not walking straight, he was limping a bit, he was passing by. So when he saw Rupa Goswami sitting there and laughing, he felt offended. He thought Rupa Goswami is laughing at him, because this man is not able to see the Aprakata Leela that is going on in that minute in front of him. But Rupa Goswami is able to see it. So he got offended, and then he went and told Sanatan Goswami, you say that Rupa Goswami is such a great transcendental person and he's a great Goswami, but he's laughing at me because I'm not walking straight. So what kind of person is he? Like that, he felt offended. And he was very upset and he walked away. Okay, so he complained to Sanatan Goswami. He was upset and he walked away. Now, at that time, just after he laughed, Rupa Goswami, his meditation broke. He could not see the Aprakata pastimes anymore. He was searching and he was trying so hard. He was trying to get back into meditation, but nothing was happening. He was not able to see Radha Krishna. Then he went and told Sanatan Goswami what happened. I was seeing such a beautiful pastime between Radha and Krishna. Radha and Krishna were joking and I was listening to it. But suddenly they just vanished. I couldn't see the Aprakata Vrindavan anymore. I could only see what, like, the Vrindavan that we see today, right, materialized. I could only see that I'm trying so hard to get back to my meditation, but nothing is happening. What happened? So then Sanatan Goswami told him that one person got offended. A Vaishnava got offended. So whether knowingly or unknowingly, he got offended. So you better go and say sorry to him, to explain to him that you were in a trance and you didn't know what was happening in front of you, and you were not laughing at him. Explain to him the situation. And if once he forgives you, you will get back into your meditation and you can again see the Aprakata pastimes of Radha and Krishna. So like that, there are many devotees actually. You know, there are tons and tons of devotees even to this day. Of course, we don't know many people in person, but it is said that even to this day, there are people in Vrindavan who can see the Aprakata Vrindavan. We don't know. I mean, they could be like just sitting there and, you know, they could just be looking like as if they are lost. But in, for all you know, they could actually be witnessing the pastimes of Radha Krishna. So in fact, I was very amazed when I went to Vrindavan. This Babaji, he's just a very nice, pure Vaishnava who takes care of Vrindakund. So usually when we start Vrindavan Parikrama, generally they take us to Vrindakund. And he's so sweet, he and his wife. He said, oh, come. You just missed Radha and Krishna. They just left from here. And I was like, what is he saying? But, you know, that's the purity level that they have. He said, they just came here 5 minutes back. If you had come 2-3 minutes back, you could have seen them playing here, he said. So like that, some people in Vrindavan are still in like that. They are in that zone where they can relish and see such things. Okay? So now, talking about the mantra. Now we have seen what happens when you chant a particular mantra and you enter into the Swarasati stage. You see the unmanifest pastimes of Krishna in front of your eyes. Now, taking an example of such a mantra, so this is the mantra that is mentioned in the Shatkona. That is, we saw a yantra, six corners, and we see a mantra written in six-corner form. Okay, what is that mantra? It has the clean bija. Bija is the clean. And then it has Krishnaya Govindaya Gopi Jana Vallabhaya Swaha. So now if you focus on the center goal of the picture that you are seeing now on your message, you can see that around Radha Krishna in the hexagonal star form, you see it is written in the center point where Radha Krishna is standing, you can see Kleem. Okay? Kleem is a love bija. Okay, bija is a seed. It is the seed of love. Okay, so you can see Kleem in the center, and then as you go around the six hexagon, you can see Krishnaya on your right top. Then you can see Govindaya on your right bottom, Gopijana on the bottom, Vallabhaya on your left bottom, Swa on your top left, and then Ha on the topmost point. Okay, so you see Kleem, Krishnaya, Govindaya, Gopi, Jana, Vallabhaya, Swaha. So this is the mantra. This is called as the Gopala mantra. And this mantra is in the form of a yantra. Okay, yantra. Now, in the yantra, you see Kleem in the middle. It is the interior of the hexagon above Krishnaya, and then you go around and you find Govindaya, Gopi, Jana, Vallabhaya, Swaha. Now, this hexagon is actually in the world, and the yantra is a diametric form of the world. Just like Krishna is present in his holy name, it is also possible for us to express transcendental things in a diagram format. A yantra is a diagrammatic form of mantra, and the mantra and the yantra are non-different from Krishna. The mantra, the name of Krishna, the yantra, everything is non-different from Krishna. And they form the six sides of the world. So when you meditate, okay, when the person is meditating, they have to meditate on the center of Gokul where Krishna is standing. And this Kleem itself represents Radha and Krishna. As you see in the center point, there is Kleem. Kleem represents the union of Radha Krishna, or rather Radha and Krishna. And one has to meditate, or when he's chanting the mantra, he should also remember the impression of the yantra on his mind. So that's how he chants. So that's why there is, the mantra is also important. The yantra is also important. Radha Krishna is also important. Everything is important. So one chants with the mantra, with the impression of the yantra in his mind. Okay? So this transcendental diagram represents the entire Gokul Vrindavan. So by chanting and meditating on yantra, one will come to know who Radha and Krishna are. It is just like chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So we say when we chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, Krishna comes and dances on our tongue, right? Similarly, when we chant this mantra, keeping the impression of the yantra in our mind, we realize Radha and Krishna. So this process is the process that Lord Brahma undertook. So why are we talking so much about this? It's because Brahma undertook this process. That's why we are seeing it in Brahma Samhita. So this mantra indicates the central world where Krishna lives, and it has 6 words and 18 syllables, the Gopal mantra. Okay? Now for the yantra means it's a machine, right? So yantra means machine. Now this Mahayantra has Kleem as the central pivot. For the machine to run, there is a central pivot, and that pivot is Kleem. It is the seed. Okay? This Kleem represents Radha and Krishna. Okay? Anyone who has an impression of this yantra concentrating his thoughts on Krishna can attain full knowledge of God, full knowledge of Radha Krishna through the process of Upasana, meditating on the mantra and the yantra. One can also realize Gokul Vrindavan with Radha Krishna. So when you practice this and you meditate, on one pastime only initially, but as you enter one pastime, you can automatically sweep through all the pastimes. You are automatically swept from one pastime to the other. Okay, so this is what we just spoke till now. I just summarized it. Now, we have to see the meaning of each of these words in the mantra. So I said Kleem is Radha Krishna. It is the Kama Bija. I already mentioned that. Now, what is Krishnaya? What does Krishnaya represent? Krishnaya represents the proper self of Krishna. That is, Krishna himself is represented by the word Krishnaya. Govindaya, it says, Krishnasya Chin Maya Braja Leela Vilasa Rupa. That means the true nature of Krishna's pastime in Braja is represented by the word Govinda. Because in the beginning class itself, we mentioned that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It is not just Krishna. It is actually Govinda who is Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That Krishna, who is the cowherd boy, is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So our particular interest is actually Govinda. So what does Govinda do? He herds cows, right? So the nature of pastimes Krishna does in Braja is actually the Govinda pastimes. Okay, so Govindaya represents the nature of his pastimes. Now Gopijana is tat parikara Gopijana Swarupa. That is the true nature of a spiritual associate. So the name Gopijana itself means the people associated, the gopis, right? The Gopijana, the entire associates who are the gopis. So this indicates his spiritual associates in Braja or Vrindavan, and who are the spiritual milkmaids or, the cowherd boys. And then Vallabhaya, Tat Vallabha. This is the true nature of self-surrender to Krishna in the footsteps of gopis. So when one surrenders in the footsteps of the gopis, that is indicated by the word Vallabha. And Swa is the true spiritual knowledge of the self, that is understanding that you are the unalloyed soul, okay? And our eternal relationship with Krishna, that we have an eternal relationship with Krishna. This is indicated by Swa. And Ha actually is referring to the manifest form of how you serve Krishna in your eternal relationship once it is awakened. So this whole thing goes through, it begins with Krishna, with Kleem, then it goes to Krishna, then it goes to Govinda, Gopijana Vallabha, Swaha. So by meditating on this, you understand that you are eternally related to Krishna in your particular rasa. And by meditating this mantra, you enter into the pastimes of Krishna in your particular rasa. So that's what this entire mantra means. Okay. So this process was undertaken by Brahma. Through this process of meditation, one can enter into Gokul Vrindavan. Staying in this material world, one can enter into the pastimes of Krishna in Gokul Vrindavan. So basically, one doesn't have to wait till he till he goes back to Goloka, but rather, in this earthly world itself, he can see the unmanifest pastimes of Krishna. Okay, so that is about text 3. Now I'll read text 4, and I'll also read the purport because it's very small, then we can explain the purport. Text 5.4. Tat kinjalkam tat amsanam tat patrani shriyam api. Tat, that lotus, kinjalkam, the petals, tat amshanam, of his, Krishna's fragmental portions, tat of that lotus, patrani, leaves, shriyam, of the gopis, headed by Srimati Radharani, api also. Now, actually, I also wanted you all to see the yantra that I had sent. The yantra is just a representation of what actually you see in the petal picture also. In the pink petal picture, you see the central point, you see a hexagon. The same thing is represented in the Gopal yantra, or it's called as the Goloka yantra. The picture that I sent, it's like a painting. If you zoom that picture, you can actually see so many things. You can see clean in the center. It's written in Sanskrit. And then you can see the entire mantra, Krishnaya, Govindaya, Gopijana, Vallabhaya, Swaha, in the center of this. And then in the yellow part, that is the orange part in the center star that you're seeing. So in the orange part, you're seeing the theme, Krishnaya, Govindaya, Gopijana, Vallabhaya, Swaha. Now in the yellow part, actually, you will see another mantra that is given during second initiation. So this is actually called as the Kama Gayatri. So the first one is the Gopal Gayatri in the center point. And then the yellow part, you will actually see the Kama Gayatri. So Kama Gayatri has this Pushpa Banaya Dhimahi, those words. That is Kama Gayatri. We get it during second initiation, not now. And then, actually, if you see the outermost circle in the white part, the beyond, you'll see that the Mahamantra is permeating throughout. Actually, the Mahamantra permeates throughout Goloka Vrindavan. These are very focused mantras, but the Mahamantra is everywhere. The Mahamantra permeates throughout. Okay, so I just wanted to make that mention. If you see the yantra, you can see how the mantras are situated within the yantra. Okay, and now the next one, text 4, we will focus more about on this yantra in text 4. Okay, so I just read the text and read the translation. The world of that eternal realm Gokula is a hexagonal abode of Krishna. Its petals are the abode of the gopis, who are part and parcel of Krishna, to whom they are most lovingly devoted and are similar in essence. The petals shine beautifully like so many walls. The extended leaves of that lotus are like the garden-like dham, that is the spiritual abode of Radhika, the most beloved of Krishna. Purport. The transcendental Gokul is shaped like a lotus. This is purport. The eternal world is like a hexagonal figure. In that, the entities, Sri Radha Krishna, appearing in the form of a mantra consisting of 18 transcendental letters, are centered. The propagating manifestations emanating from the chit potency are present there with the said entities as the center. Sri Radha Krishna is primary cause or the seed herself. Gopal Tapani Upanishad says, Omkara signifies the all-powerful Gopala and his potency, and clean is the same as Omkara. Hence, Kama Bija, or the primary cause of all love, is connotative of the entities Sri Radha Krishna. Now, I'll elaborate in simple words on what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati writes. Okay, so this is verse number 4. So if you look at the yantra now we saw the central point, okay, we saw the orange part. And I also told you a little bit about the yellow part, that it has the Kama Gayatri, which has this word, Pushpa Banaya Dhimahi Tanno, something, Prajaya, all that we can't say, but it is there. Okay, the yellow part is there. Now, if you see the yantra as well as the other picture, which has the petals, it's a long shot which I've sent along with all the petals. Don't focus on the center point. Focus on all the petals. So if you see the first row of petals, you will see the Ashtasakis. Okay, so you will see the abodes of the Ashtasakis. Who are the Ashtasakis? They begin with Lalita on top. Then you will see Vishaka, Suchitra, Induleka, Champaklata, Rangadevi, Tungavidya, Sudevi. So these are the Ashtasakis. The abodes of the Ashtasakis are situated around the center point where Radha Krishna is standing. This is how the abodes of the Ashtasakis are. So just after the world, you will see that the Ashtasakis are standing there, or you see their abodes in Goloka Vrindavan. That's where they are. Then in the next little petals, you will see right above these Ashtasaki petals, you will see small petals, you know, that are coming on top of it. Those are the Manjari petals. So you will see from top, you can see Ruta Manjari, Rati Manjari, Lavanga Manjari, Manjuali, Raga Manjari. Then you will see, who's this? Kasturi Manjari, Guna Manjari. Then you see Vilas Manjari. Vilas Manjari. So beginning with Rupa Manjari, you will see an entire circle of Manjari. So the abode of the Manjaris are around just the next level, or they are the next level of petals. You will see the Manjaris coming. Okay. So like that, as you go around a circle, first you see the first row of petals. like the Goloka Vrindavan is like a lotus. Okay, so the world, Radha Krishna, they are standing together. Then the first row of petals is the gopis, the Ashtasakis. Then you will see the Manjaris. Next, you have the Manjaris standing. So their abodes are situated like that in the spiritual world. Okay. So according to the yantric description, the Ashtasakis have their own special places where the petals are. And the places in between the petals, you know, in between the petals, there will be some place, right? That is like a garden-like dham. And in the spiritual abode, these are places for Radha Krishna pastimes. So between the petals, the pastimes of Radha Krishna will happen in the spiritual world. So between two petals, there will be some places, and there the pastimes will happen. Okay, so further petal, and if you see a little more, so we saw two rows of petals. We saw the first row is the Ashtasakis, then we saw the Manjari. So you keep seeing further, you see the pastimes of Radha Krishna happening in different places, different dhams, different places within Vrindavan. You'll see the pastimes of Radha Krishna happening with the gopis. Okay, so these are all pastime areas in the petals. And then you go furthermore, you go to the next row of petals, you will see the childhood pastimes happening. You will see the abode of Nanda Yashoda. You will see Nanda and Yashoda. There's one petal where Yashoda is dressing Krishna, Balram and Krishna. Like that, you will see the places where Krishna's parents are there. And then there are little leaves, like green leaves that are actually present. Actually, we don't see that clearly here. But there are green leaves which are cow pastures. And the lines around the petals, they're somewhat whitish, right? There are whitish lines around the edges of the petals. So all these are they are actually the places where the pasture land is there. And these are gardens. These are actually gardens where Radha and Krishna enjoy their pastimes. So all these lines around the petals are gardens where Radha and Krishna go and enjoy pastimes. Okay, and they're also pathways. They also represent pathways. Like when you have to go from one place to another, you take pathways, right? So these edges of the petals, they act as pathways. And this whole thing is like a lotus. Just like you see a lotus closes and opens, like that the entire dham closes and it opens. So the edges of the petals are like pathways, gardens. They are like pathways. So when Radha and Krishna have to move from one place to other, actually they're using those pathways. And as the petals close and they open, their transport becomes, you know, they can start transporting from one area to the other. That's why we say the whole Goloka Dham is like a lotus. Similarly, when we talk about the Vrindavan that is there in our earth, actually it is like a lotus. It closes and it opens. That's why Krishna is able to commute such great distances so easily. Like the previous class, we were talking about how he comes to Kalia Ghat so easily from Nandagaon. Because the entire Dham is actually a lotus. So it facilitates the movement of Krishna so easily. Like that. So like this, Krishna moves easily in this abode, and everything in the abode is actually very animated and transcendental. And a little more notes on clean, because Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati talks about it in the purport. He says clean is in the center and it represents Radha Krishna, and Omkara, that we are all familiar with, Om, signifies Gopal. From the Gopal Tapani Upanishad, we know that Gopal is represented by Om. Okay, Gopal and Radha, actually, they are represented by Om. This Om is the same as clean. Hence, Kama Bija, which is clean, is Radha Krishna. So, he's bringing out a relationship between Om and clean. He's saying Om and clean are the same. And both Om and clean, they represent Radha Krishna. And Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, he gives a very rasika understanding of clean. There is so much about clean, so many commentaries about clean, this Kama Bija. So Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur gives a very, he's a very rasika bhakta. So he gives, especially he's an expert in Madhuri Rasa. So he gives this understanding of clean. He says ka in the clean, ka, k, it represents Krishna. And then la, clean, right? La, next, the next syllable is la. It represents Radha. And their embracing is ma, clean. Kla, ka is Krishna, la is Radha, and ma is their embracing. And the dot over clean. So when you see clean, K-L-I-N, there's a dot on top of it, right? The clean it is. So the dot on top of it represents their kissing. So this is the Kama Bija, the love between Radha and Krishna, their embracing and kissing. So that is the meaning of clean. Radha and Krishna are standing, embracing and kissing. So that is the meaning of clean. So that's all for today. I've just elaborated on the purports based on the seminars of all the three Maharajas. So I'd like to stop here. Thank you so much. If I think we have to help each other to answer questions, because even I don't understand many parts, but I just try to explain what I heard. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you for a wonderful class. Like I mentioned earlier, like I spoke to you, right? Like I read the verse, but it was not some part really. Majority of the verse was very advanced, but I think your class kind of simplified everything. So it's such a good verse. So one question I have regarding the Aptakita Lila. Remember like the pastime of one of the devotees of Pandal, Jiva Goswami, Dukhi Krishnadas, who was later named Manandha Prabhu. He just found the anklet and Srimad Radharani had to come and take it, right? So my question is like, that's not a pastime as such that he witnessed, but he had Srimad Radharani herself come and take that anklet. So can that also be called a Aprakata Leela?
Not really. That pastime comes under the explanation of Gokula is an extension of Goloka. Like you can transport between Gokula and Goloka, Gopakumara was doing. So that pastime is a good example for that. Saying that this Gokula is an extension of Goloka and they are always connected. You know, that is a good example for this point.
So that is like a Prakata Lila only.
That actually the pastime that happened in he could connect to Goloka Vrindavan. Like he had a, what do you say? Like how Gopakumara was traveling between two places.
I understand.
He could enter even the Goloka Vrindavan. Like actually Radharani herself comes, right, to claim that.
Okay. Nice, Mataji. Thank you for a very good class once again. I really have no more questions. I'm eager to hear more about it.
Thank you, sir. I don't know if Bhakti Vinod Prabhu is there. Yeah, Hare Krishna Mataji. Devati Mataji, tell me.
Can you carry on, Mataji? You were talking something. Like
no, I was telling if I'm making any mistakes, we can correct or something. Even you guys can correct if there are something, there are some mistakes in what I'm saying.
Thank you so much, Mataji. I came to know so many things, but I will listen the class one more time and I'll ask the questions, Mataji. It's like way too high for all the information, like whatever you have given. I haven't never even heard about all these things, actually. But thank you so much, Mataji. Thank you for your
Thank you so much, Revati. Thank you for joining us. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Namaskar. Away from my standard, Mataji. This is the kind of class, Mataji, because I like Brahma Samhita very much, Mataji, because it has so many details. It hits the head. I mean, you give the point. Not like you talk about so many things and finally they talk about some interesting thing. But this is all interesting, Mataji, for me. Because of the planets, all this, everything, I don't know, Mataji. For some reason, I like Brahma Samhita very much, Mataji, but I never read completely, Mataji. Mataji, I got a couple of questions, Mataji. So, when Krishna came onto this earth, right, Mataji, so he came as a cowherd boy. The reason we heard from Acharyas, because he wanted to glorify the Yadu dynasty. So that's the reason he took birth in a cowherd family and he fulfilled that one. So, but in Goloka Vrindavan, where he is on his own, there is no dynasty, there is nothing, only Krishna, right, Mataji? Why there is a cow in the picture? And also we are calling him as a cowherd boy, in the form of cowherd boy in Goloka Vrindavan. That's my first question, Mataji.
Okay, wait, we'll go question by question. So your question is, Krishna came here to glorify the Yadu dynasty and hence he played the role of a cowherd boy. So why should he be a cowherd boy in the spiritual world? Is that the question, Prabhu?
Yes, Mataji.
Okay, so first of all, actually the Yadu dynasty, the Yadavas, they were not cowherd people. The Yadavas were the Kshatriyas, rather the descendants of Yadu. Yadu, Puru, Kuru, all of them, they were sons of Yayati. And Yadu was actually not given the crown, right? So later, when Krishna went back to Dwaraka, only he ruled as the descendant of Yadu. That is, as the son of Vasudeva and the grandson of Ugrasena. Grandson of, yeah, Only when he went back, he was right. Am I wrong or am I making a mistake? Because I thought Cowherd Boy had nothing to do with being from the other dynasty. Is it correct?
Yes, Mataji, you are perfectly correct. Yadu dynasty refers to the Yadavas who are in Dwarka. Until he comes out of Vrindavan and goes to meet Vasudeva and Devaki, he is not really connected to Yadu dynasty. Rather, he is more connected to Yashoda and the other Brajavasis, who are again eternal in the Goloka.
Mm, that's true. So his original form is a cowherd boy only.
When you were talking about Mataji, it's a 18 syllable Gopala mantra, you said. It's a 18 letter, you mean, right, Mataji?
Mm-hmm. 18 syllable, six letter, I think. Syllable means like each note, like clean.
Like what?
What
is syllable, Mataji? Is it like a word or?
Syllable is like Krish, Na, Ya, Go, Bim, Da, Ya, Swa, Ha, like that.
Okay. The sound.
Sound is a syllable. Correct.
Yeah, I got confused with Hare Krishna mantra. We say 16 words, right? 16 syllables there also. They say.
Yeah.
So I got confused, Mother. Yeah. Answer, Mother. Mother, one question is, if you are looking at that picture, right, Mother, which you shared, there is the yantra in the center, Mataji, hexagon. Mm-hmm. And inside the hexagon and also around, right, Mataji, where Radha mm-hmm. and Krishna are standing, right, there are orange circles, right, Mataji,
mm-hmm.
inside the yantra itself,
mm-hmm.
in the star. What are those, Mataji? Sorry, Mataji?
In which picture, Prabhu?
Yeah, in the picture where Radha and Krishna, the photo is there, Mataji.
Where they are standing, there are in that
not painting but a photo in that one, right? If you see it right in the triangle in the bottom, right, in the small triangle, there is one orange circle or globe kind of thing, looks like some kind of thing. What are those?
I don't know, Prabhu, maybe they are just trying to represent a whirl of a flower. That, you know, inside the whorl of a flower, there will be like a small stamens kind of thing. Maybe they are representing that. I don't know. I'm just guessing. I don't know what it is. But figure it out in future as we advance in Brahma
Samhita. I can only ask questions, Mataji. That's all.
Yeah. Maybe in future we'll understand, Prabhu.
Yes, Mataji. Yeah, that's a hope, Mataji. Yeah. That's a hope.
And I don't know exactly. I think there's stamens, like, you know, inside the center point, there'll be like dot. I'm just guessing, no idea actually what it is. Let's figure it out in future if it comes.
Mataji, one more thing. Got this question, Mataji. Say related question. So this one, desert tree, right, Mataji? It's a symbolic, right, Mother? It's not a real tree, right? So symbolically, they say it's like an inverted desert tree in material world. It's symbolic, or it's a real tree itself?
Actually, they say all the trees in Vrindavan are Kalpavriksha trees. That means they will give you whatever you desire. So that's why they say when you go to Vrindavan, you go and pray to the trees, actually. That's where you actually should go and pray. But you should pray for like spiritual service or something, rather. You should not pray for anything material. And immediately they will give you what you desire. So that's why it's called Kalpavriksha. So all the trees are Kalpavriksha in Vrindavan. And even in the spiritual world also, they are Kalpavriksha only. Because if you go to a tree and you don't have to go and pluck the fruit or something, just tell the tree, okay, give me your fruit, it will give you a fruit. So tell the tree, I want this, it will give. Like that, that's how they explain in Goloka Vrindavan. It's so magical. That's how it is. So.
Yeah. Because Radha and Krishna, they are standing,
standing under the Kalpavriksha tree. Yes, Prabhu, that's right.
One thing I missed, Mataji, because my my problem. So in the Bija, right, Mataji, clean, right? K, you play the sound Krishna, La for Radha Devi, And what is M stand for, Mataji? The sound M?
So K is Radharani, Li together, okay? Li together is Radharani, K is Krishna, Li together is Radharani, Ma is their embrace, and like you know, when you take Ma, you're supposed to take M, like that, okay? Klim, that dot is represented by taking Ma inside, like Klim, like that. So that dot represents the kiss, the M represents the embrace between Radha and Krishna. This is Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur. He is very rasika. That's why he'll talk like this. Yeah, he enjoys Madhuri Rasa so much.
So. Sure, Mataji, got it. Mataji, last but one question, Mataji. In Goloka also we have, I mean, like you mentioned, we have Prakritika and Aprakritika Leela, right, Mataji? So you give an example of Damodar Leela. So Damodar Leela, people at that time, right, Mataji? It was a Prakritika Leela, right, Mataji?
At that time it was Prakritika.
So only, even though we are on the same planet, now it has become Aprakritika, right, Mataji?
Correct.
All the problems. Okay, Mataji, understood, Mataji. One last question, Mataji. So first thing, the steps you mentioned, right, Mataji? First step is like you have to chant, and then you start meditate on a pastime and enter into that one and see through all the pastimes. So when do we draw a line? So these two things go together, or at some point you promote to pastimes and stop chanting, or while meditating also you chant. So where do we draw a line between these two steps, Mataji?
I think, I mean, this is only my understanding, I could be wrong, but you meditate, you chant, you meditate, you keep this in your mind and you keep meditating on a particular pastime, you chant a mantra, you meditate on the pastime, and then you enter the Swaraski stage, that is you enter into the pastime and you flow from one pastime to the other till you come to external consciousness. Like it goes on and on till a person is drawn back to external consciousness because of other diversions or whatever. Maybe he is in that zone for a long time, but then he gets back to external consciousness. If he has to enter the Leela again, it looks like you have to meditate again. But once you have perfected the process, I think it's easier to get into the process. I'm only guessing, Prabhu, but I don't know, I could be wrong. It's just a random answer I'm giving you. I'm just trying to use my intelligence to answer you.
Sure, Mataji. It's always correct, Mataji.
Yeah.
You're intelligent.
No. I don't have a Shastric thing, Prabhu, but I'm just saying maybe this is how it could be, because based on Rupa Goswami's pastime, he tried to get back to by meditation, he tried to get into the Aprakata Leela again, right? That's what the pastime says. So he tried to do it again, and then it was failing. He was not able to go back. Easily he could have gone, because he's gone through it several times. So for him, it should have been easy, but he couldn't go. Because it was apparently an aparad, no, unknowing aparad. And then he met an apologist, and again he could go back to the past tense from once the apology was done. So it looks like that.
Sure, Mataji. Yeah, that's all my questions, Mataji. One observation, Mataji, if you remember, when we have that chanting class at Mataji, in one of the books, they mentioned Arohana, Avarohana. So you start chanting, then eventually you launch into some pastime. The Avarohana is you start with your meditation, and then keep chanting. So at that time, that Maharaj he mentioned, if you start with your meditation, right, Mataji? So then you may not concentrate, you may not focus on the chanting. So little observation, Mataji. So I'm a little confused on that two different practices. But anyway, both are like chanting and meditation. Both are good, Mataji, but I just...
go ahead, Prabhu.
Just I heard for the same exactly what Prabhu asked, the same question was asked in one of the lectures I heard. I'm not remembering who the speaker was, but what it was said there. We are all sadhaka siddhas, so we get perfected by our sadhana, which means even after going to spiritual world, we have to still continue our sadhana by chanting process. So what was told is that that we start keep chanting, and as our Krishna consciousness keeps or as we grow in our devotional service, this we get involved in pastimes also. So, but however, as long as we are getting involved in pastimes, it doesn't mean we are stopping chanting. In fact, our chanting is so strong that Krishna is letting us into his pastimes.
Mm.
So it's like the chanting keeps growing stronger and stronger, and more pastimes we keep enjoying. So both go hand in tandem. They don't really. It's not like, you know, you totally get involved in pastime and you stop chanting, or you don't get involved in pastime but you only keep chanting. That's not like that. That's what I was told, Mata. As you keep advancing, both keep going, and chanting keeps increasing even more stronger. It becomes stronger, and your pastimes are more. You get more invitations into your pastimes of Krishna.
Wow, nice. Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you for clearing that. Thank you. Nice. That makes sense now. Like even for the question that is like going back to meditation, because the intensity of chanting is also like, you know, improving, and they are more easily able to get into pastimes. So chanting continues. Yeah, makes sense, Prabhu.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you, Mataji. That's all, Mataji. After, you turn off the regarding rate, Mataji, I have one thing to share, Mataji. After,
yes, sir.
That's one. I'm done with my question.
Yes, Prabhu. Hi, both.
Mata, I think we are done with questions, right, Mataji?
That's all? No, yeah, we are done. You can continue, Prabhu.
Do you want to turn off the recording, Mataji, star 9?
No, we can have the recording. That's a good news, right? I'm expecting it's a good news. So we can have the recording. Even Nandanandan is waiting for you to hear that.
Recording. Oh, I should press star 9. Okay. I didn't understand what was happening. Star 9.